Hello everyone, so today we will cover the second learning objective with respect to the research project, which is how to carry out a literature review. So remember that literature review is a full chapter in your research project, whether it is a proposal or a dissertation. So the length of the literature review, it may vary based on your assignment guideline. Generally, for a dissertation project, a literature review is around 3,500 to 4,000 words. And for a research proposal, it may be between 1,500 to 1,800 words. So we will move ahead. And so these are the contents that we will be covering in today's literature review session. It will be like to study the process of conducting literature review, understand the connection between literature review and research objectives. So this is very important. We also discussed this in our last session. And then to comprehend appropriate ways to construct your literature review, which means that how do you approach it? What are the different steps involved in conducting literature review? And then to be able to combine abstract concepts to form an integrated conceptual review. So this is basically related to how you combine all your literature review information into a conceptual framework, which will guide you for further chapters of data collection and analysis. So moving ahead, we will continue with our session. And so we discussed the structure of the proposal in our last session, which is chapter one is introduction, which we covered in our last session. And chapter two is literature review, which we are going to cover in today's session. So just a quick recap on what we covered in our yesterday's session. So we covered the introduction chapter, which comprised of the background information, basically a brief introduction to the research topic that you have chosen. Then what is the research gap, or then why is the research interesting to you? So that you need to justify. Then you need to identify the research gap and then define the aims and objectives. So to emphasize again, aims and objectives are the most important part, which will guide you throughout your entire dissertation. Then once you have defined your aims and objectives, then you can identify the research questions on similar line and research hypothesis as well. So we move ahead to conducting literature review today. So this we also discussed in our last session. Your objective one and objective two are achieved using the literature review, which means that you will conduct a critical review of literature. You will report what are the findings, and then this will be reflected in your conceptual framework. So this is how you use the literature review for your dissertation. So to begin with, let's look at into the different types of literature review. So when you do assignments, so they are basically, you need to go through just a selective review of your research topic. So your course assignment, you relate your assignment, you relate the academic theories and concepts with your assignment. So it is just a selective review of the literature, and it's a standalone work. But when you extend this further, when you are doing a specific literature review of any topic, for example, project management or talent management, so that becomes even more comprehensive. So that becomes a literature analysis, like what have the past academicians worked on it, what have they suggested. So that is what becomes a comprehensive analysis. Then when another form of selective, but a part of broader work, is your journal or studies, journal studies or articles. So if you review a journal, for example, if you pick up a journal, for example, say Strategic Management by C.K. Prahlad or Michael Porter's say 5-4 framework. So you will review only that aspect. So that becomes a part of broader work, but it is still a selective work. On the other hand, your dissertation or a thesis or your research proposal, this comprises of a broader work as well as a comprehensive work, which means you have to do an extensive review of literature. So ideally for a dissertation, you need to have at least say 25 to 30 journals which you have reviewed, and then you have presented your work in the literature review chapter. In a proposal, if you are doing a literature review of say 1500 to 2000 words, you would need to review approximately around 10 to 15, roughly about 15 journals. So that is what is the difference between a selective review and a comprehensive review. So let's move on to the process on how to conduct literature review. So basically your research project, it will seek to provide explanations or solutions to real issues in a live context, which means that you have picked up a research topic or identified a research gap which you feel is interesting and which you feel has a practical context. For example, if you are studying the issues of privacy in social media, so that is a practical topic and it addresses real issues in a live context. So therefore, what you need to do is you need to try to review as much work that has been done in similar areas. For example, privacy issues, what are the challenges faced in providing say e-commerce solutions to customers, and what are the privacy issues, and then how does social media address these privacy issues. So this is how you go deeply into the literature. So you need to include other relevant theories. For example, for social media theory, for social media dissertation, you could use theory, for example, technology related theories, or probably human behavior related theories. So those theories can be used when you are doing a literature review. And then you need to develop critical and conceptual faculties, which means that first of all, you need to define the topic, or you give introduction to the topic, and then you go on to say this researcher has said this, the strength of this argument is so and so, or the weakness of this argument is so and so. So that way you slowly get into the topic and you review the work done by other academics in the related fields. So some of the main sources of literature review are books. So if you want to pick up any definition, so books are your good source. You can use books directly for citing, but you need to provide the accurate reference, means which page number and which book and the entire referencing. So that is important. You can review other people's dissertation. Then conference papers are also a very good source, but the best source for your literature review is your scholarly articles, which is your peer-reviewed journal articles. So to go through those journal articles, what you need to do is, first of all, you can look into it broadly through using Google Scholar. And then whichever articles you find interesting, you can download those. You can see with your library access whether you can have those articles. If you don't have, you can write to us. We will get you those articles. So ideally, your aim should be to review as much of peer-reviewed journals as possible. So in this slide, we look into the basically the what is the authenticity of, basically what is the weightage of each of the literature review sources. So the referred peer-reviewed journal articles, they are given the best quality review, which means that they are the best ones which you can refer. So it provides research literature and experts on current research and theory. So you should target using as much of referred journal articles as possible. Then you have referred conference papers, which means that again it provides you an insight with the literature and experts on current research and theory. So, but its weightage is slightly below the peer-reviewed journals. Then you can use edited collection of referred works. For example, these works are generally deemed of sufficient significance to be reissued, which means that they have reviewed the original work and they have presented it in a in a new format. Then you have unreferred conference paper and journal articles. Then you can, if you are doing a secondary research, then you can also use trade publications, market research reports, but you need to give the references appropriately. Finally, you can use textbooks. You should avoid introductory texts, but you should get the idea, the concept from the textbook. If you want to get the definitions, you can take it from the textbooks. So these are the main sources of literature that you should review. Always remember that a blog is never considered as a credible source. Wikipedia, you should never use it for literature review. These are never considered as a credible source. No blogs, no Wikipedia. So you should be very clear when you are reviewing the literature. You can go through blogs and literature review to understand the concept, but you cannot cite those in your literature review. So the key areas of literature, it includes your theoretical literature review, which means that you are reviewing some theory. For example, if you are aware of healthcare, the progress on healthcare. So if you want to review, carry out a theoretical review, you can go through the journals and then you can use it as a key source of literature. Then contextual review. For example, if you're conducting a study on an organization, for example, Tesco, maybe human resource practices in Tesco. So what you need to do is, you can use the annual reports of company as a source of information. You can use the journals as a source of information. You can even use, say, magazine articles as source of information. So, but again, blogs and Wikipedia, they are not used. So when you use, try to make sure that the weightage of journal articles and other credible sources, for example, annual reports, are higher. So that way you will have a high weightage of quality literature in a contextual review. Then you have a technical or practitioner review. So these are used for generally technical papers which others have presented, and then some researchers, they present the supporting or contrasting evidence. So you can use all of these as key areas of literature. So you can, but there is no requirement to exclude practitioner publication, which means that you can think, okay, theoretical and contextual are important. Practitioner is not, no, it is not like that. You can use all the three, or you can use selective theoretical only. It depends on what you are doing as your assignment. So some of the key aspects that you need to remember in literature review is that be very sure of the veracity and currency of the literature you use. So what does it mean? Veracity, it means the credibility, the truthfulness of the source of information. Because of this, because of veracity, you cannot use Wikipedia or blogs. Why? Because Wikipedia can be edited. So there is no single source of information. Then what you can use is journals. They are peer-reviewed journals. They are, reviewed by certain scientific community or academic community. Then annual reports, they are authenticated by the company. So that means there is a single source of truth for all this information. Then currency, it means how current is your source of information. For example, you cannot use annual report of Tesco of 1998 stating that the talent management practices are being used in 2020. No, you have to use the latest one, 2019 annual report or 2020 annual report, whichever has been published. So that way you should make sure that you use only the current information in your literature review. Then other aspects is like, you should think like, what is the literature review telling you? Who wrote it? I mean, whether it has been written by a company source, whether it has been written by an academic community, whether it has been written by a market research company. So who wrote it? How old is it? Which means you have to check out the latest versions. And then how does it address my research objectives? So before we look into how does it address your research objectives, how old is it? So for any literature review, you should make sure that you use only last 10 years of data. That means if it is 2020 today, you should use literature review from 2010 to 2020. That is very important. The supervisors, they look into it like your how current is your source of information. So moving on to next, like how does it address my research objectives. So what you need to do is you have to link the literature to your research objectives, whether there is a coherent flow of information, whether it covers the topic you have identified in research gap. So that is what you need to do when you are conducting a literature review. And make sure that your research objectives are the guiding point for your entire literature review, data collection, data analysis, and presentation of findings. So your entire research, it will be guided by the literature review. So now we look into the important steps in literature review. So how will you go on? For example, if you are novice, you are just starting with a research project. So how are you going to conduct a literature review? So the first step is choose a topic, which means, for example, if you have chosen social media, privacy in social media, then you explore this topic. You give the keyword on your Google Scholar search as privacy in social media. Remember, social media is a very broad topic. Your research should be focused. So for example, privacy in social media, or social or use of social media marketing. Again, that is a specific topic, but only social media is a very, very broad topic. So you should be specific in your research. So the first step is you choose a topic, and then you focus and explore this topic. Read as many journals as possible. See what the past academics have said in the past about the topic. Then step two is research. Collect scholarly information and sources, which means that you go through the peer-reviewed journals, go through the books. Books may be very, time-consuming. The journals provide you with the best source of information. If you don't have time to read all the journals, at least you can go through the abstract, which is a very short, basically summary of what the research has been conducted about. So if you feel it is relevant to your research, then you can go through the entire journal. So that is step two. Then step three is analyze the network of information and select works, which means that you segregate or separate the journals which you feel are most relevant to your study. And then you analyze the network of information. How does it relate to your chosen topic of research? Does it provide a flow of information? So that way, your literature review has now focused from being very broad to being very narrow. Then next step is to describe and summarize each selected articles, which means that when you do that, again you will get to know what is the logical flow and how are you going to use it in your literature review, which means that describe and summarize each selected article. So every article, you present what the researcher has said, what the academics have said, what is the strength of the argument, what is the limitations of the argument. Have other researchers agreed to this argument, or have they presented contrasting findings? So that is how you describe and summarize. And then demonstrate how concepts in the literature, it relate to the chosen topic, and establish how the literature is connected. So this is what I was saying, that it should be a logical flow of information. That is step five. You connect the different literature, and then you, by saying, for example, this point of view is also supported by so and so, wherein the author stated that privacy is a key issue in social media. So that way you can provide a logical flow to your review. And then in the final step, identify relationships in the literature and connect your ideas to them, which means that how are they related, what is the supporting argument, what are the contrasting arguments. So basically this is how you arrive at a coherent sequence of your literature review. So these steps are very important. If you are not able to comprehend or understand any part of it at one point, you go through it over and over again, and I strongly suggest that you follow these steps while conducting your literature review. So let's summarize on what we have discussed on conducting a literature review. So basically, the first thing is that you conduct a thorough literature review before a literature survey which you start, which means that you identify all the journals or the books or the articles which are relevant to your research, and then you ensure to present the research problem clearly. Your research problem or your aims and objectives should be very clear in your mind. So that way you will get to know which literature to select. Then compare and contrast the different views in the sources. So who is supporting the argument, who is opposing the argument, has somebody presented a new insight? Then that way you will get to know how to relate to the different sources. So you mentioned the paper. So one of the most important thing is that you mentioned the paper's methodology, analysis, research instruments, and equipment used in the study, which means that some of the researchers, they may use qualitative methods. Some of the researchers, they may use quantitative methods. So for researchers who are using qualitative methods, they may be using interviews. For researchers who are using quantitative methods, they may be using survey questionnaire and statistical analysis. So you need to mention that, okay, this research was conducted, however, it undertook only a qualitative survey, whereas this research, it presents a different finding. It presents a more robust way as it, the sample size is higher, and it presents a closed-ended survey questionnaire. So that way you can justify or mention the paper's methodology. And few bits of information is that you should remember to cite properly and limit the bias. That means even if you feel that you have a different opinion, stick to what is the literature. So you can include certain statements that this is based on the argument that social media is being adopted widely across the world. So that is a general statement that you can use. It does not bias your literature review. And finally, you need to summarize the strengths and weakness of the study, which is very important. So we discussed on how to, what is the process of conducting literature? What are the credible sources? Basically, what is the weightage given to the different sources of literature? And we discussed the different steps of conducting the literature review. So now let's look into the different constraints on literature review. So it depends, like the scope of the literature, wide or narrow. It depends on your research objectives. So your research objectives again guide you to focus on your research. And then access to literature, which means that suppose if you have very limited access to literature, then you must try to make the best of what you have. For example, if you want some help with a journal article, you can write to me, or you can write to UK University, then we will provide it to you. You feel that for you conducting your research, you need to get access to that document. Then what you can do is you can get access to that literature. Then time factors, very, very important. How much time do you have? Because when you do a research project, you need to prepare a research plan. Like when you are going to complete chapter one, when you are going to complete chapter two, when you are going to complete chapter three. So your literature review again is dependent on how much time do you have for conducting the literature. Then ability to understand the literature. For example, if you are an expert person in social media, you understand all the concepts very clearly. It will take lesser time for you to understand the literature. But if you are a person who is new to the topic, but if you are interested in the topic, it will take a while for you to understand. So based on that, you need to dedicate time for your literature review. So remember, literature review is very crucial, whether you are in your bachelor's, your master's, or if you are going to do a PhD. At the master's and above, literature review becomes very, very important. In fact, any academic review becomes very important. So you should be aware on how it is to be carried out. And then we have the integration of literature search and analytical framework. So which means that you need to present a conceptual framework based on whatever literature review that you have done. So the core objective of literature review is to be critical. So you need to develop a critical reflex. So like we discussed earlier also, like think, what is this telling me? Who wrote it? how old is it? So this you had visited earlier also, I'm emphasizing it again. And then how does it relate to your research objective? So you have to be very critical. You cannot just take the information, like whatever is presented to you as it is. You need to be critical on what information suggests you. So in this age of information where there are many fake news and many manipulating news which seek to incite the behavior of people, you need to be very critical of what the content suggests you, or basically what the literature review suggests you. So you need to think, what is missing from this that you might reasonably expect to be included? So in any literature, none of the, if you pick up any journal paper, it is not complete in all aspects. So you need to think, okay, what else could be included to make it a complete one, or to present even more robust findings which can be very convincing. So what is missing? So you need to understand, you need to basically analyze this. Then is this misrepresenting the contextual specifics of the issue that you are addressing? For example, if you are addressing the issue of privacy in social media, but one of the journal article, it states that users, they themselves put up their information on social media, so privacy is not an issue. So again, you will have to analyze this. What is the researcher saying? Is it misrepresenting? Definitely yes, because even if the users put up their own information, it is selective information. But if the social media site is getting data based on the browsing behavior, based on the transaction behavior, so that itself relates to the issue of privacy. So that again is your core research area. So whatever journals is there which are misrepresenting the facts, you can state on your review that, however, this contradicts the generally accepted argument that privacy is very important in social media. This is because the researcher states so and so. You can present the view, but you can say that this is a contrasting argument. Then another aspect is it over prescriptive, under socialized, and unjustifiably upbeat, which means that is the researcher very convinced of this? What is the basis of it? Why are they being unjustifiably upbeat? So here you can voice your concerns that even though the researcher is very much convinced that privacy is not an issue, there are other research which have highlighted to the contrary. So that way you can work in your literature review. So the key argument here is you have to develop a critical reflex. You should not take any information based on its face value, which means that whatever is written, you should analyze, is it true? Has the issue been completely reported here? What am I missing? What information do you need to get a complete idea on the information? So again, I'll give you an example. For example, people say stock market, they give you good returns. But what is good? What are the risks involved? What is the investment profile of the investor? So these aspects are not covered in any report that you find. So you need to understand the risks, the investor profile, how much money are you going to invest? What is your return expectation? So these aspects, these provide a complete picture. So I hope you're understanding. So this is how you develop a critical reflex. Then we move into the next topic, which is the conceptualization. So whatever literature review you carry out, it should be conceptualized into a diagrammatic framework, which makes it easier to understand and makes it easier for you to collect data. So the concepts are abstractions from reality, which means that it could be a person, a machine, time, or a theoretical base for analyzing the internal elements of organization. For example, it could be human resource aspects in Tesco. So what are the human resource aspects? It could be for example, career progression, it could be remuneration, it could be flexible working policies. So this is how you conceptualize the different aspects of a topic. In the next few slides, we will look further into it. So these are building blocks at master's level, some of which are also measurable. For example, service quality. Service quality is measurable. Quality of goods, it is measurable. productivity. Again, you can measure like out of 40 hours in a week, how many hours are actually productive. So that way, some of the concepts are measurable, but some of the concepts are not measurable. For example, leadership. Basically, what is your leadership quality? How do you rate your leadership? So it's very difficult to quantify it. Similarly, strategy. So that's a strategy you have. Strategy, you have certain specific or quantitative targets. That's how we measure strategy. Then motivation. How do you define whether you're feeling motivated or not? For example, are you feeling motivated 2.75 out of 25, or are you feeling motivated 12.35 out of 15? So that way it's very difficult to quantify motivation. So these aspects you should consider in mind when you're preparing your conceptual framework in the literature. So how do you prepare a conceptual model? So a conceptual model, it represents the connection of the different variables based on theory and logic to display the major relevant research constructs, which means that it shows the link between independent and dependent variables on how you are going to conduct the study, how you are going to collect the data. What are the independent variables that you have identified? What is a dependent variable? So the variable constructs are often represented as geometric shapes with arrows that may point to the dependent variable. So we have an example of conceptual framework, which we will show in the next slide. So you need to keep in mind that you need to just show the relationship between what you have reviewed from your literature. So the possible problems are whether there is an implied causality, whether there is unidirectional relationship. So that's how you prepare a conceptual model. So here we have an example of conceptual framework. For the research topic and investigation of impact of brand equity on consumer purchase decision, a study of Samsung UK. So this is a research topic. So based on this, we discussed what are the aims and objectives in our yesterday's session. So here, see, the components of brand equity are brand awareness, brand loyalty, brand association, and perceived quality. So these are independent variables in the concept, in the literature review, in the basically conceptual framework. And you have to study their impact on the purchase intentions, which is the dependent variable. So this is how you portray a conceptual framework. So let's look at some of the aspects of conceptual framework. So here we are. So a conceptual model is a diagram that connects variables, which means we have seen the different variables of brand equity on the left side, which are the independent variables. So, and then they display the visually the major relevant research constructs. So these are the different research constructs. Then the variables are often represented as geometric shapes with arrows that may point to the dependent variable. So consumer purchase intentions are the dependent variables in the conceptual model. So again, after looking at the diagram, I hope you are visualizing it better. So are the relationships shown accurate? I mean, have you derived this from literature review? Have you used an already existing framework? So basically, from where have you prepared this framework? So is it accurate? Then there can be problems such as implied monocausality or unidirectional relationship. But before that, you need to get this information from your literature review. Then high quality conceptual model. How do you prepare a high quality conceptual model? So this model, it provides the structure for chapter 4, which is your data collection and analysis. So remember, chapter 1, introduction. The most important part is your aims and objectives. Chapter 2, literature review. Again, entire literature review and the conceptual framework, very important. It provides a base for data collection and analysis. So it enables a highly structured and relevant presentation of the empirical data, which means that it tells you what aspects of data you're going to collect, how you're going to collect data. For example, if you mentioned a quantitative study and in the conceptual framework which I showed you, so it becomes very clear that you can collect 5 questions on each of the variables. So You can have 20 questions on the independent variable, 5 questions on the dependent variable, and then you can study their impact. So brand awareness, 5 questions, brand loyalty, 5 questions, brand associations, 5 questions, perceived quality, 5 questions. So why it has become easier? Because you were able to formulate a conceptual framework, and then you were able to list out questions based on this conceptual framework, and then you can collect data on this. So it becomes very easy. So it is a framework which you will use in chapter 4 to present and evaluate your findings. So that is the characteristics of a high quality conceptual framework. So we look into this slide again. So we cover objective 1 and objective 2 using literature review. Remember, literature review carries almost 30 to 35% weightage in your proposal or dissertation. So it is very, very important, and the more you practice, the more literature you review, the more compelling arguments you present, you will get higher marks and your understanding will increase. So that's why literature review is very important. So I again emphasize on the importance of objectives on the literature review. So for example, if you have too many objectives, which means that you will be reviewing many journals, which again is difficult because you have a time constraint on your assignment. Or if you have very few objectives, it may not meet the criteria of your assignment. So ideally, I would always recommend 4 to 5 objectives maximum, at least between 3 to 5. It can be 3, it can be 4, it can be 5. So my personal preference is 4 research objectives. The first 2 based on literature review, which covers your independent and dependent variables. The 3rd one is related to your data collection. And the 4th one is related to your recommendation, which is based on your data findings. So 4 objectives are the ideal. So that's how you should also work upon for creating your research human objectives. So you always need to remember that if your literature review is too wide, many models may appear to be relevant, and this can lead to a dysfunctional, which means that you are running around different directions. So in plain and simple terms, it won't make any sense. Then an overblown literature review may look great on paper, but it makes its utility to chapter 4 very much questionable, which means how you're going to collect data. So if you have 10 independent variables, are you going to formulate 50 questions and send it to the research participants? Remember, nobody has that much time to fill in the 50 questions. The moment you say 50 questions, they will start saying, oh, I'm sorry, I don't have the time. So it should be feasible. If you're doing a survey question, not more than 15 to 20 questions. That's it. It will take 10 to 12 minutes of your participants' time. They are also happy, you're also happy. And remember, a massive literature review will result in a massive chapter 4 requiring huge efforts to collect data, collect analysis, and present the data. Again, that's what I was saying, that it's a very, very challenging job if you have a large amount of data. So be to the point, identify 3 to 4 objectives, do a literature review, present a conceptual model, and then you collect data. So that's how you should do it. So that is all for today. If you have any questions, you can let me know.
Hello.
Yes, Matthew.
I have some questions. It's Matthew here. My first question was some parameters have been given, such as 15,000 to 18,000 words, and I was just wondering about time frameworks. I think there was a mention in the last lecture about time frameworks versus length and what is actually producing, and I was just wondering if you were doing a 15-week intense masters, could you actually produce a research thesis within that 15 weeks?
Yes, definitely. If your thesis is say around 12 to 15,000 words, then you can do it in 15 weeks, which is 4 to 5 months time. But if it extends beyond 15,000 words, if it goes to 20,000 words, probably you would have to ask more time from the supervisor. That's probably a 6 months job.
Super. The other thing is, I was thinking about plagiarism, but of course, plagiarism, I mean, when one's looking at doing a review, it seems almost mutually exclusive because you're looking at other people's works anyway. But then I was wondering about this term research assistant. Is one allowed a research assistant, and is there a limit to the amount the research assistant can contribute to the literature review?
So what type of research assistance are you implying?
I mean, if one paid somebody, if someone approached one to say, I'm going to help you, pay me and I'll go and dig some books out for you relating to this and help you get going with it, is that illegal?
Unfortunately, that is secondary plagiarism. So
yes,
that is not allowed anywhere in UK or anywhere else, because it's basically you're paying someone to do your own work, which means that
yes,
how are you going to define the boundaries, whether he has done only literature review or whether he has done the entire dissertation. So no, it is not even allowed even a single bit.
That would include
it's a
your
great
husband
idea, Matthew. I wish I'd thought of it.
If they were studying as well, doing their own, I suppose you'd be interfering with each other's. Yeah.
No, that means collusion, and that means you're taking the assistance. See, the whole idea of academic knowledge is that the knowledge developed by you, that the university or any institution is able to impart to you knowledge so that you can try to grow on your own self. So if you're outsourcing this thing to another one, so it doesn't serve the purpose, right? So that is the basic idea behind it. And then all the universities, they take it very seriously. And any form of, primary plagiarism, you can detect on the Turnitin software. Secondary plagiarism is difficult to detect. But what happens if you go for a higher institution, some of the supervisors, they know, like, what is your level of knowledge. And when they see a very good work, they will start doubting that, okay, this is not your work. I know your work. This is not your work. So when that comes, then the whole panel or the whole committee will sit, they will decide secondary plagiarism, they will ask you, they will ask each and every bit of you, okay, from where have you got this information? Then you may get caught. So you see the problem over here, right?
One other question to finish with the last one. It was a question of three-dimensional models and animations, because, I mean, if one's using PowerPoint or something, you can use videos and or pictures or models and things. But obviously, one, I suppose, a strict thesis in a university is always just paper, I suppose. It doesn't include animations. I mean, I remember way back the ZX81, the first home computer, it had a game called The Game of Life, and it was about O's, and you'd move O's a bit like replicating bacteria, and you put them in different shapes beside each other. And I remember I was thinking about this because of COVID-19 and trying to illustrate the R number and showing how it dies away or increases, the Game of Life on the ZX81. I thought that would be a good thing to put on a presentation, but that's an example of an animation as part of a thesis, and I was just wondering whether there is any animation allowable in the submission, and if others present animations. I'm thinking about these diagrams that were mentioned. If you're researching, you come across an animation, do you have to then describe the animation in words because the animation can't be reproduced in the thesis?
Oh, definitely. You can definitely use animation. So this animation, probably you'll be doing it in some software. You can be doing stimulation, and then you can present your results as an appendix, or you can present the final output, and then you can explain, this is the before stage, this is the after stage, or this is the phase one stage, or this is the phase two stage. So definitely it is acceptable. You can, and in healthcare, probably you will have to be working in such kind of models. So you're always welcome to use these animated forms. You can take a screenshot from the software, you can attach it, and then you can probably say, highlight the red areas or the blue areas. These are the changes that have appeared. So you're getting my point, right?
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
And Matthew, I just wanted to add as well that one of the ways I found of shortcutting a little bit because of the research is that when I'm going through articles or I find something that I feel is interesting enough to read, I can use the accessibility on my iPhone or on my iPad to read the article to me.
Mm-hmm.
So I can continue to do other tasks, for example, you know, that don't need my brain power. So, you know, it cuts down on that time where you have to sit and physically read it. You can have it read to you by your iPhone or your whatever phone you've got using the accessibility settings.
Oh, definitely. See, if you are going to do that, books, obviously, you can read as a podcast or like e-book reader. So definitely you can do that. You don't have to read the physical book. The idea is to derive knowledge. The knowledge is what
to gain that knowledge. But I use Kindle Audible, you know, all different kinds of things, just so that it's pumped into my brain, but I'm not physically having to sit down and read, you know, the article or the book. You know, it's pumped in via my ears. So. That's how I get around it.
Yeah, definitely. Because the medium is not important. Gaining knowledge is important.
Yes.
So, thank you, everyone. Anyone else has a question, they can let me know. Or you can always write me. So, what I'll do, I'll send all of you an introductory email about what we have covered and what is the plan for the next week. And so that I will also send you just an initial thought that you can decide on your research topic, and if you feel comfortable with sharing with me and seek feedback, I'm always ready to do that. So I'll send you all of you an email today, so just to get to kick started with your the choice of topic. At least in the next 1 week, probably you should have a choice of topic or some research area which you feel is interesting or where you want to proceed.
Wonderful.
Okay, so great. Thank you everyone for your time. Have a nice day.
Thank you very much. Happy Sunday. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.